talking about the effects of genome duplication on transcriptome size or the total transcriptional output, the effect of genome duplication on the total transcriptional output in the cell, as well as on individual gene dosage responses, or in other words, what effect does a doubling of gene copy number have on the transcriptional output from that locus. And so we know that polyploidy has dramatic effects on the genome, and that these are associated with a spectrum of phenotypes. To name a few, we see larger cell sizes associated with polyploidy, oftentimes larger organ sizes and faster growth rates. And so to really understand how polyploidy and changes in genome size mediate these phenotypes, I suggest that it's necessary to understand the effects of genome duplication on transcriptome size and gene dosage responses. And so to illustrate why I think this is true, you can consider two hypothetical cells with the transcripts in the cell represented by these wavy lines. And so you can see that cell 2 has threefold larger transcriptome than cell 1. And then you can imagine the gene of interest, which I've shown in these orange wavy lines, that is also threefold more highly expressed in cell 2 than in cell 1. So now in a typical expression profiling experiment, you would deeply sequence RNA from these samples, Illumina HiSeq, and then you would normalize the raw read counts for your gene of interest by dividing the reads you obtain for your gene of interest by the total number of mapped reads from the sample. And this would produce what I call a transcriptome normalized expression estimate, or expression per total expression from the sample. And so in both cases, you would get expression estimate of 0.25, in other words, 1 divided by 4 or 3 divided by 12. So this would indicate the standard normalization procedure would indicate this gene of interest is equally expressed between the two samples, which is correct on a per transcriptome basis, but it misses the fact that it is in fact threefold more highly expressed on a per cell basis in sample 2. To really understand the effects of expression on phenotype, particularly in the case of per cell phenotypes, such as the larger cell phenotypes that we see in polyploids, it's necessary to look at expression per cell. That expression per cell is more likely to be the driver of these phenotypes than expression per transcriptome. And you don't get this unless you know transcriptome size. So does transcriptome size really vary that much? It turns out that the answer is yes. I cite just a few examples here where related samples show twofold or greater differences in transcriptome size. These examples and others are described in a review paper that Jeff and I put out a little over a year ago, if you're interested. So in order to estimate total RNA transcriptome size, what we're doing is co-extracting DNA and RNA from the same tissue and quantifying yields of the two using qubit assays to estimate an RNA per DNA ratio, which is in effect the total RNA transcriptome size per genome. And then we're estimating genome sizes by flow cytometry to get DNA per cell, and then simply multiplying RNA per unit of DNA times DNA per cell to get an estimate of RNA per cell or transcriptome size on a per cell basis. We've done this in a polyploid complex in the genus Glycini, which includes a cultivated soybean, or GMAX. The subgenus Glycini diverged from soybean about 5 million years ago. It includes a number of diploid species that have crossed in various combinations to produce 9 different polyploid species, all within the last 500,000 years or so. So this is a powerful system for looking at recurrent patterns in response to genome duplication. And then sort of zooming in on the complex, I'm showing 3 of the polyploids that I'm going to be talking about today that are shown in the boxes, T1, T2, and T5, flanked by their diploid progenitor species in circles. So for example, T2 was formed via hybridization of a D3 and D4 diploid. Okay, so starting with leaf tissue from this T2 polyploid, here are the RNA to DNA RNA per DNA ratios we observe in the polyploid, shown in blue, and its diploid progenitors in orange and gray. And you can see that there's a reduction in transcription on a per genome basis in the polyploid relative to its diploid progenitors, roughly two-thirds. The expression per, the transcriptional output per genome in the polyploid is about two-thirds that of the mid-parent diploid progenitors. We see smaller but similar reductions in the T1 polyploid, as well as the T5 polyploid. And then we've also looked at root tissue in T2, and again, see a similar sort of pattern there. So again, these are allopolyploids, meaning they are formed via hybridization, and they've also been evolving for upwards of 500,000 years. And so with these, we can't say whether this pattern we're seeing is the effect of polyploiding per se, or whether it's an effect of hybridization. And it's also not clear from these data whether this is an immediate effect of genome duplication or if transcriptome size changes over time. And so to try to address these questions, we've started working with Arabidopsis synthetic autopolyploids induced by colchicine. So we can look at transcriptome size responses in these polyploids to see what happens in the absence of hybridization and in the immediate aftermath of genome duplication. And we've done this with three different accessions, C24, WS, and Columbia. So here again are the results, the leaf results for the Glycini allopolyploids. And here's what we see in the Arabidopsis autotetraploids. And you can see that we're seeing a very similar kind of reduction in the autopolyploids as we see in the allopolyploids, suggesting that this is a sort of perhaps a consistent response to genome duplication. So this is total RNA that I've been talking about. So what about the messenger RNA, which is probably less than 5% of that total RNA? What about mRNA transcriptome size? In order to get at this, what we did was we used these RNA to DNA ratios from the total RNA transcriptome to estimate, you know, how much DNA there is per microgram of RNA in a given sample. And then we spiked in our RNA samples with ERCC, or external RNA control consortium, synthetic RNAs in proportion to the amount of DNA present. And then we sequenced the samples with Illumina, and then normalized the plant RNA reads by the ERCC reads to get essentially transcripts per unit of DNA. And then we also did standard RPKM normalization to get an estimate of transcripts per total transcripts. And if you divide that first ratio by the second ratio, it basically solves for total transcripts per unit of DNA, or transcriptome size, mRNA transcriptome size in this case, per unit of DNA. And so these are the results we got for the T2 root tissue. And what I'm showing here is the distribution of transcriptome size estimates. So for each gene in the data set, we get a separate estimate of transcriptome size. And this is the distribution of those estimates of transcriptome size for the polyploid relative to its mid-parent. And then on the x-axis is the number of genes binned in each range. And what we see is that mRNA transcriptome size, we get a median estimate of about 0.68. So there's about two-thirds the level of mRNA per unit of DNA in the polyploid as there is in the mid-parent. And this is strikingly similar to what we see in terms of total RNA, suggesting that the mRNA and total RNA transcriptomes are coordinated. We see a very similar estimate in the T1 polyploid, and notably also in an Arabidopsis autopolyploid. So it appears from these data that this transcriptome size response is a conserved response to genome duplication. Specifically, that when you double the genome, you end up with about 70 to 80% the level of transcription per genome in the polyploid that there was in the diploid parents. And this holds true for both messenger RNA and total RNA. It also holds true across multiple species, including natural established allopolyploids in talking so far about sort of global transcriptional responses, but what about individual gene dosage responses? So, for example, if a gene is present in two copies in a diploid, then it produces a certain amount of transcripts, which I just set at one here. If you double the copy number to four, and if that causes a doubling in transcript abundance, this is referred to as a one-to-one dosage effect. Alternatively, if there are some silencing mechanisms such that there is no change in transcriptional output with a doubling gene copy number, this is referred to as dosage compensation. And then there are various other possibilities, such as like greater than one-to-one dosage effect, or partial compensation, or what I'm calling intermediate responses, and then negative dosage effects, where a doubling in gene copy number actually causes an absolute decrease in transcriptional output. And so, because we spike in ERCC in proportion to DNA in our RNA-seq data sets, we have essentially a direct readout of expression per genome from our RNA-seq data. And then if we basically divide those estimates from the polyploid by the diploid, that gives us our dosage responses. So this is a sort of a representative distribution of dosage responses we see in our data set. We can use the confidence intervals for each gene's dosage response to assign it to one of these five bins. So for example, if a gene's confidence interval overlaps 1 but doesn't overlap 0.5, we put it in the one-to-one dosage effect. So here is the distribution of dosage responses in the C24 Arabidopsis autopolyploid after binning it into these five discrete categories. And you can see that the major bin is this intermediate or partial dosage compensation category, which is consistent with the fact that the overall transcriptome is partially dosage compensated. And here I'm showing the distribution in C24 in comparison to one of our glycine allopolyploids, T1. And you can see that the general, roughly speaking, the two show similar distributions, with again this intermediate dosage response being the most abundant. But that perhaps there's a shift towards smaller or even negative responses in the established flow polyploid relative to the autopolyploid, suggesting that perhaps over time, or maybe initially, there are larger dosage responses that are then shifted downwards. We did a gene ontology enrichment analysis to see if similar kinds of genes show similar dosage responses in Arabidopsis and glycine. And we do see some interesting commonalities within for example, within this intermediate dosage response category. In both species, they're enriched for genes that function in translation. And in the negative dosage effect category, both species are enriched for cell wall and extracellular matrix functions. And recall that polyploidy increases cell
part, have you looked at the, whether it's, are you able to tell allele differences with this type of data, or like from parental lines?
Yes, in theory, with the allopoint lines at least,
we can,
and I have worked on separating out expression by allele or homeallele, but I have not paired that up with the dose response data yet to give you any specific answers on that.
Yeah, I'd be curious if there were allele differences in that intermediate category.
Meaning like is one homeolog being expressed and the other silenced or
something like that.
I'll be looking into that. Yes, one of our other long-standing interests is photosynthesis, and we've shown in the allopolyploids that they have elevated photosynthetic capacities on a per cell basis. And interestingly, when we did RNAs, the first RNA-seq experiments we did were actually to sort of investigate this phenotype, and just using standard normalization, RPKM normalization, we didn't see any expression level differences in any of sort of the typical photosynthetic genes. But if we account for differences in transcriptome size, we actually do see upregulation in almost, I think, 9 out of 11 Calvin cycle gene families, which are the carbon-fixing enzymes of photosynthesis, and are pretty strong candidates for underlying this photosynthetic phenotype. So we think that that's a good example of why transcriptome size is important for evaluating transcriptomic data, especially in the context of polyploids. Yeah. Yes, we do recover a lot of trans-T's in our RNA-seq reads. I've never really done a careful analysis of them, but we do see a number of T's in there. So we did kind of look at that, not probably as rigorously as we should, but we did not see any real obvious differences in T abundance in the polyploids. That's what we were sort of speculating that we might see an increase in T abundance in polyploids, but they basically look similar to their diploid progenitors. This is in glycine. We haven't looked in the Arabidopsis data for TEs. I think that's entirely possible. We really haven't done anything to try and get at mechanism for what's causing this partial compensation, but that certainly is a possibility. It's worth exploring.
Yeah. Oh, so you more passionate that genes that are only partially compensated to see if there's something cis-regulatory illness that they share.
So different genes with different promoters that share the same dosage response.
Sure.
Look at their focus. Yeah, that's an interesting idea. We have not done that, but that would be an interesting approach. Okay.